Elizabeth, thank you for the very generous introduction, and my thanks to the American Friends of Turkey, the Turkish Coalition of America, and also to the Institute of Turkish Studies. Sinan Gidi is on his way to Chicago, otherwise he would have been here. Okay, let's see if I can get this turned on. All right, I'm going to put you back in high school and talk a little bit about what is history, because people will always come to you and say, you know, history says, history shows, and I caution people about that. So we're going to go back to high school a little bit, talk about history. Then I'm going to talk a little about the Ottoman Empire's approach to counterinsurgency, persistent war, and then discuss the committee approach to insurgency and how that threatens the Ottoman Empire. This leads us into World War I and the threat that these committees and communities present to the security of the empire. And then I'm going to put it in context. I'm going to talk about the relocation context. It's not unusual. It's not unique to the Ottomans. It's not unique to this time period. And I think this is the part of the lecture that eyebrows tend to raise on is the relocation context itself. It takes about 45 minutes, I think, and then I'll open up the questions if you have time for that and you want to stay for those. All right, I'm a military historian. I'm not a political historian. I'm not a genocide scholar. I don't dabble in economics. My experiences as a historian are framed by 27 years in uniform. I've been in conventional combat in Iraq. I've been in insurgency, counterinsurgency in Iraq. I've been in peacekeeping in Bosnia. So I've been around the dance floor quite a bit. That frames my approach to this problem. I wrote a book on World War I. I spent 10 pages on the Armenian Rebellion, and I got hate mail from Armenians. Vakhtang Dadrian wrote up a scathing review of the book based on 10 pages out of 300, and it piqued my interest. So I got out of my lane and I started to look hard at what I thought was what I had called the Armenian Rebellion. I looked hard at the events surrounding what happened in the spring of 1915 in eastern Anatolia. And it really took me out of my lane, in a sense. But I spent 5 or 6 years researching this, going to Ankara, looking at some of the archival sources, puttering around, writing articles, and then it morphs into this book here, Ottomans and Armenians. I would just throw it out that there's about 70 shopping days until Christmas, and there's the present for your dad or your son or whatever. Buy the book. You'll love it. No, I kid people. It's unless you're a military historian, it's tedious. And despite John's kind remarks, most people would probably be hopelessly bored by the content. It's a military history. It talks about battalions and regiments and movements of troops and counterinsurgency policy. My next book comes out in March, just in time for Gallipoli. I'm now back in my lane. This is a new approach to Gallipoli. It looks at decision making at the operational level. Nothing quite like this out there. So I'm now back in my lane, and quite frankly, I'm kind of done with the Armenian Rebellion at this point. I've given this lecture several times around the country. Armenian people have come to it, and at the end of it, just hound me relentlessly. So if there are anybody here that wants to chat about this after, I'm more than willing. All right, history. We often hear people say, history shows. Or history demonstrates. And what I'm here to tell you is, it's not true. You will never find a history book that is entirely free of some predisposition, some pre-writing bias on some part. You can write history any way you want to. There's a raging debate right now in Colorado and Texas on the AP history curriculum and how the AP, the Advanced Placement History test is packaging its view of America. And you wouldn't think this would bother people, but it does. It polarizes people. You can make history say anything you want, and it changes. The history of Lincoln's cabinet today is different than it was 10 years ago because of that book about Lincoln's cabinet in the movie. So history changes as we go through time. Questions I always ask, whose history is it? Who owns the history? Who benefits from this narrative and the way we tell the story this particular way? It serves an interest. It's used in ways that are subtle. We use American history in high school to rationalize the American experience for young people. It serves a curricular purpose, and history is written this way. I'm going to go into an interesting sidebar here on a book called Destiny Disrupted by a historian, a scholar named Tamim Ansari, and use that as a good example for understanding the narratives about the spring of 1915. History affects the thinking of people. It affects the thinking of populations. Okay, that's what you learned in high school if you went to school in the United States, and you'll recognize the Romans and the Greeks and the Renaissance and the Reformation and all those things lineally put in chronological order rationalize history for American students. And it explains that. That's why the curriculum does what it does. It explains to young Americans why democracy, why capitalism work. It justifies and rationalizes the United States. This is, it's a rationalization. Okay, this is Ansari's model. Now, there it is, according to Ansari. I'm not a Middle East scholar of curricular matters, but he suggests, he says, at least in most of the Middle Eastern countries, this is how the narrative is packaged. Now, these are roughly the same events, but they're packaged differently. And you've got the, what we call the Crusades is a catastrophe for these people. Christians come in from the west, the Mongols come from the east, and they squeeze and they take and they wreck everything. The permeation of the east by the west, the Sykes-Picot Agreement, all that stuff that the imperialists do in the Middle East that sets it up for disruptive destiny, in this man's words today. This, in the Middle East, explains the Islamist reaction. This narrative, this package, doesn't explain democratic capitalism. It explains the Islamist reaction. It explains the Islamic State. It explains Al-Qaeda. It explains all that stuff. What Ansari says is that you cannot, should not try to explain the Islamist reaction with our narrative. It's an interesting point. How do we understand the Islamic State today? IS, ISL, whatever you want to call it. We understand it through the lens of the West. And it causes us great difficulty. Why is it we have such a fractured approach to dealing with the Islamic State? Part of the reason is I'm not sure we understand them. Ansari would say we can't. You don't. You've got to be a Middle Easterner, understand what's going on there. So, how does this affect what I'm talking about? All of this stuff creates a predisposition on the part of any historian, any person toward certain things. We pride ourselves on standing back and being objective and saying, okay, I'm going to let the archives speak for themselves. I've heard that a million times. I've said that myself. Yet what happens is our framework is a lens through which we look at history. And we have received wisdom. We have things, foundation myths from our forefathers. We have zeitgeist. We have the spirit of the times. We have selective memory, where we choose not to remember some things. We overgeneralize as a culture, as a people. All people do this globally. Historians try not to do it. We try to distance ourselves from it, but this cannot help but infect, honestly, everything we do as historians. Okay. There are five major narratives about the events of the spring of 1915. They all originate from the same body of material. All the historians writing have access to the same stuff, but the interpretation is different. So there are five major narratives. One is ethnic homogenization, the idea that the Young Turks wanted to purify ethnically, racially, Eastern Anatolia. That's one view. Intent to destroy. This is the genocide argument. That starting as early as 1909, 1910, the Young Turks, with a a racist ideology intended and set out to destroy the Armenian population. That's the second narrative. That's the most popular one in the West, unfortunately. Cumulative radicalization, Donald Bloxham's argument, that things just happen. One darn thing leads to another, and the Armenian committees and unrest in the context of a global war, and the Turks start moving a few people here, moving some people there, and there's some shooting and some massacres, and all of a sudden it mushrooms into a regional event. So cumulative radicalization, this is a compelling argument. Things start small and they get bigger, and all of a sudden what they thought they could control, they can't, and it's out of control, and away they go. Retaliation and justification. This one is a Turkish narrative we have to kill the Armenian, or the Armenians, sadly, were massacred because they massacred Muslims. And it was reciprocal. And one side shoots one person and the other side responds, and the idea of justifying what happened because of retaliatory, we did it because they did it. That argument goes nowhere. State security, major insurgency. This is the one I wrote about 10 years ago. I believe there was a major Armenian rebellion in eastern Anatolia that was such a threat to national security in 1915 that it had to be dealt with heavy-handed, hard tactics. I've come off that. None of these arguments fully explain what happens. So what I have is a sixth narrative, a military narrative. The relocation is a subset, it's a tactic of a counterinsurgency strategy designed for a specific purpose. So my narrative is a sixth narrative. Are any of them right? I don't know. Your guess is as good as mine, honestly. The one that I've written about seems to fit all the facts as I put them together. I have a lot of questions. You know, how come 350,000 Armenians aren't relocated? How is it that only a portion were relocated selectively? How is it that anybody survived? How is it that there's a huge volume of messages in the archives, not only in the Turkish archives, but in the Russian, the British, and French archives, speaking to a rebellion? So the questions I ask drove my research and led me to this sixth narrative. It fits all the facts. I don't reject the other narratives. They might be true, I don't know. And here's the honest truth. Nobody knows the whole story. Nobody can conclusively, positively say right now something happened or something did not happen. We don't have all the facts. That's the sad, simple truth. Linguistics is a problem. Who reads Ottoman Turkish? I don't. I don't read Russian. I mean, the skill it takes to go through all the material doesn't exist in a single person. So we have some historians looking at stuff, making small baby steps, and people eventually will put this stuff together and synthesize it. That's what's happening with this particular thing. Okay, the sick man of Europe. You're familiar with this. The Ottoman Empire is decaying. It's losing ground. It's lost ground since 1620. It's gradually getting chopped up and taken apart by the Europeans. It has a primitive, agricultural, unindustrialized, undereducated population. It's weak as a government in the hands of a sultan, a hereditary ruler. It's got problems. Famously called the sick man of Europe. 1914, World War I rolls around. And it is neutral initially, and we'll get into that. Okay, it is weak, and because of this, it is subjected to rebellions empire-wide. I get it that the Armenians were unhappy. I get it that the Albanians and the Yemenis and the Arabs and the Kurds, how could they not be? How could anybody in a multi-ethnic empire ruled by other people be happy? They're not. They aren't happy in Austria-Hungary. The Serbs aren't happy. The Bosniaks aren't happy. The people in the Caucasian republics aren't happy in the Russian Empire. So I get that. I get truly that there is a certain level, a threshold of oppression that exists in all these multi-ethnic empires. and rebellions break out in all of them, more so in the Ottoman Empire, to the point where for about a 30-year period, we have a phrase military people use today called persistent war. We're in the middle of one right now. It seems endless. Started in 2001. Now it looks like we're going to go back to it in Iraq and Syria. So you live with a persistent war. It wears countries down. It wears populations down. It weakens government. They have this problem. And they have rebellions everywhere. There are unhappy Armenians in the Constantinople and Eastern Anatolian area, and they rebel. There are Bulgars and Macedonians who rebel in what's now Northern Greece and Macedonia. There are Kurds who are in rebellion all the time. There are people down in Yemen who rebel all the time. There are Greeks on Crete. There are Arabs in the Arab Peninsula. There